All right. All right, let's... let's start out our worship service. Let's sing Before the Throne of God Above. All right. Technology. You gotta love it. Well, while Bob's figuring that out, let's open up in a word of prayer, okay? Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this opportunity to come and worship today. We're thankful that Carl is willing to share with us the Word of God in Colossians, and I just pray that in all that we do, Lord, we'll do it with the spirit of giving focus and honor and glory to you, that you will be pleased with all that we do in our worship, whether it's the singing or giving or praying or listening to the prayers or the preaching, the listening to the preaching, all of it, Lord. Our fellowship with each other after service, all this, that, Lord, we would do it in a way that would glorify and please you. Thank you for all this. Now we ask for your blessing on our service, and I pray this in Jesus' name, amen. Well, let's start out with announcements today. All right. Our services that we have, as usual, we have Sunday school, and Carl is teaching Sunday school. We're doing a series on Messiah in the Old Testament, and we still have several months' worth of that, too. So even if you haven't been a part of that, I would encourage you to come 9:45. We go from 9:45 to about 10:30-ish, and it's been a very good lesson. In the afternoon services, I'm teaching various lessons that would help us as we're looking for a new pastor. And we had a business meeting last week, but the week before that, we looked at the pastoral requirements as outlined in 1 Timothy and in Titus. This week, today, we're going to look at the Baptist distinctives, and this will take a few weeks to get through this, but, you know, we're a Baptist church. What is it particularly that a Baptist church believes that separates us from, like, the Methodist church and the Episcopal church and so on? Well, that's what we're going to be talking about for the next couple weeks, and then we'll do other series that'll help us be thinking when we're looking for a new pastor. What are some of the core things that we have to ensure that this pastor believes and will direct the church? On Wednesday nights, I'm also teaching that, and we're that's at 6 p.m. on Wednesday. We have a Bible time and prayer time, and we're going through 1 Timothy. That is a letter that Paul wrote to Timothy as he was a young pastor of an established church. And again, we're doing it with the idea of thinking as Paul's directing Timothy, and he's telling Timothy, this is the way you should conduct yourself as a pastor, and this is the way you should expect your church to conduct themselves under your direction. And so we're looking at that. So I invite you, take the opportunity to come to these teaching times that we have, especially the Sunday school, the afternoon service that we have at 1 o'clock, and on Sundays, and the Wednesday time. It's much more casual and intimate, very interactive. So if somebody if who's ever teaching says something and you've got a question or a comment on it, there's opportunity to do so. So a great learning opportunity. So I encourage you all to take advantage of those. Coming events, we have the ladies' book study is going to be on Saturday, November 4th from noon. From 10 to noon. and you're going over chapter 4 in your book. Angie will be leading. If any of the ladies have not been attending or they need a book, I would talk to Angie about it, wherever she is. There she is, where she always is. Angie, do you know, do we have extra books? Okay, but if somebody wants to start coming, we certainly could order books for them. Also, November's coming up, so we're going to begin our food shower drive. So you can bring in non-perishable foods, and we'll put them on the back pews there. We're gonna move a couple people out of the pews eventually, and we will distribute those on probably around Friday the 17th, which is the Friday before Thanksgiving. So you have up until Wednesday the 15th to get your food in for the food shower. Keep in mind, this is November. November's coming up. The 5th of November, which is the first Sunday, will be the last day to get deacon nominations in. I've got another year in my term, so I'm not up for vote, but Carl DeVries is, and if you can think of anybody else who fits the qualifications for a deacon laid out in 1 Timothy, what I would suggest is, you can put their nomination in the wood box there, on a little sheet of paper in the wood box on the table in the hallway, and then Carl and I would look at those and vet them out, make sure the individual qualified, talk to the individual, see if they're even interested, and if so, in December we'll be voting on these new deacons. For the second Sunday, the 12th of November, Bob and Teresa Sturgeon, our missionaries to Bolivia, will be here and spend the day with us. Bob is going to teach Sunday school and the morning service, and then we're going to have our harvest dinner potluck after that. So Bob and Teresa will be spending that with us. And we do have a sign-up sheet for the potluck over in the hallway there, so go ahead and look to see what. By the way, I have to say, Pastor Wagner was really into desserts and stuff, and if we could bring popcorn or something salty, those are desserts for me. Although I can say I do love pumpkin pie, so okay, that's my pitch. I think that's all the announcements. Does anybody else have anything else that I missed? Oh, I'm sorry. At our business meeting last week, we had talked about getting new blinds. These blinds are falling apart here. They're all taped up and all that. So we went out and looked at a couple blinds, and blinds cost, like, nowadays to get a decent blind, it's going to cost $100. Well, we looked at a couple of blinds. One was $100, one was $200. And you could tell the quality was different. But we bought one of the $100, it's sitting on the back table. Is it still there, Kim? It's sitting on the back table back there. Take a look at it after service. Let us know what you think. You can let Carl know, or Kim know, or me, but let us know what you think. We wanted you to look at that before we made the mass purchase, because, like I said, it's either $100 or $200 per blind, and we have seven windows here and two windows and a window in each of these back rooms here. So, but take a look at it. We want to know your opinion on it. I have a letter, a card here, really pretty. And it says, this is from Barb, and it says she has 1 Thessalonians 5:18 quoted here. She said, "Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus." And then she says, Dear HBC family, so many things to be thankful for. These last couple of weeks have shown me what I pretty much already knew. What an awesome group we have in this room. So many prayers, hugs, texts, phone calls, cards, gifts, and food. Not having to think about cooking was great. Thank you all so much, and may God bless you. Love, Barb. And I'm sure Larry agrees with some of that, too.
But, I just have to say, he is the most wonderful man. I mean, he has taken such good care of me. It's unbelievable.
Dr. Larry. All right. Well, good. And I'm glad to see that you're doing well, too, Barb.
Yeah. Better every day.
Yep, and she says she's ahead on her PT and all that, you know. Very good. For those of you who don't know, she had a knee replacement surgery, so 2 weeks ago, yeah. How we doing, Bob? Are we ready? All right. Let's go ahead and try and do our first hymn, Before the Throne of God Above. Okay, we did announcements already, so let's go right into our next hymn then, and that is Bow the Knee.
Bow the knee. It's a short reading today, but in Philippians chapter 1, Paul says, "I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, making request for you all with joy, for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ." Isn't it nice to know as a Christian that what God has started, he will complete?
Okay, we'll sing two more songs, and then Carl will come back up and share the word of God from Colossians with us. So let's sing "Complete in Thee." Okay, and then our last hymn before Carl come back up, it will be hymn number 522, "My Savior's Love." And we're going to sing the first, third, and the fourth.
Presence of Jesus the Nazarene.
Not used to that yet, are you, Paul?
No.
You'll get there. It's okay, because I wouldn't have remembered either.
The qualifications for volunteers have to be a little older than me.
Not going to say a word about that one. Let's pray, shall we? Father, as we come before you, just take our hearts. May the Holy Spirit just work in them to truly show us what you have for us today, what your word says, and just put your blessing upon this time together, for we'd ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. As we've just briefly looking at the first part of Colossians, we looked at the introductory materials with Colossians, a city approximately, if you look at your maps and your Bibles, you can see where it is, but it's about 100 to 120 miles east of Ephesus, and in the vicinity of a couple other cities, Laodicea and Hierapolis. Laodicea turns up again, by the way, in the book of Revelation, where God talks about it and the church there and the problems that were there. But then last week, we looked at Paul's thanksgiving, because while he had not apparently met any of these people, he heard about them from Epaphras. And as a result of that, he was giving thanks because he was getting a good report from them. But now he says that he's going to, or that he prays for them, and he's going to tell us what he prays for them. And I think that's really, really an important thing. And prayer is something that we all should be better at. It's something that's really, really important, and God tells us that we should be praying. Maybe many of you may have never heard of a man, but his name was George Mueller. And Mueller was known as a man who prayed a lot. And he had an orphanage that he ran. In fact, over the course of his career, he had thousands of orphans come through the orphanage. And one day they all sat down, and this is, by the way, a very well-documented incident, but they all sat down to eat their breakfast, and there was no food. There literally was no food. And Mueller actually said, well, let's pray, and he prayed, and he thanked God for the food they were about to receive. He finished his prayer on the door, and the local baker came in with enough bread to feed the entire orphanage. At the same time, the milkman came up and his cart had broken down in front of the orphanage, and he had enough milk for all of those people. There's a man who prayed and a man who believed that God would answer his prayers. Would that we prayed with that kind of faith. And Paul is not one to ignore prayer. I mean, we just read from Philippians, where he prayed for the Philippian church, and he prays for the church in Colossae. He's heard of their faith and love. He's thanked God for that. In fact, it's kind of interesting because he talks about their faith and their love because of their hope. And I suggested that it's because of the things that they do in faith and because of the work that they do in love for the Savior who has saved them, and they have, because they have this hope. God has saved them, and he said, here's something coming in the future. Now go do something for me. And they do. Well, we're going to take a look and see what Paul prayed, and it's kind of interesting here because several times in the epistle, Paul will talk about I this or I that, but here he says in verse 9, for this reason, we also. And remember, early on, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother. So he's including at least Timothy in this and possibly some others. But he says, for this reason, we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you may have a walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing him, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power for all patience and long-suffering, with joy giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has delivered us from the power of darkness and translated us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. As Paul comes to pray for these people along with Timothy, because I'm sure Timothy was a part of this, he said, "We don't cease to pray for you." And that doesn't mean that Paul was on his knees every minute of every day praying just for the Colossians. But this was a habit with him to pray. So let me ask this. What is my habit? What is your habit to pray? You know, in talking about things that we as church members can do to help keep things going until we have a new pastor, it's entirely possible that somebody says, "Well, I don't really have any great talent," but you can pray. What if a person who says, "Well, I really can't do this job and I can't do that job and I really don't have any talent to do this job, but Lord, help me to pray." And you take, for instance, the church directory. And each day, you start right through the church directory and you pray for two people. And the next day, you pray for two more, or another couple if you wish. And you work your way through the church directory over and over again. Think what God might look at doing if we all did that. And not just praying. And I'm sure Paul appreciates your prayers for him as he works to lead in this whole matter of getting another pastor. But what about things beyond that? What we're going to look at today are things that we should be praying. As Paul prayed for these people, we should be praying for each other. And he says, first of all, that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will. And that thing, that whole phrase about being filled is a passive verb. In other words, it's not something that they strive on their own. I'm going to be filled with the knowledge of God's will. It's what God gives them. That we pray that God will fill us with a knowledge of his will. Knowing his will as a whole is important. Not just, well, should I eat this or that today, or should I wear this, or should I go see this person today? But a whole aspect, all the aspects of God's will, that and in particular in this passage, that we grow in Jesus Christ, in who he is, and become more like him as a result of it. And we're going to see that as we work our way through the book. But he says, filled with a knowledge of his will. And this idea is not just, well, a little bit here and a little bit there, but a filling. You know, it's kind of like, I would never do this to anybody. If Carl wanted a cup of coffee, I would never, ever pour that thing up to the brim so that it wouldn't move. Would I? Yeah. Never. That's filling. But now in that case, you don't want to pick up the cup without getting some of that coffee out of there. And nor would he do that to me, by the way. But it's the idea that you are full of the knowledge of God's will, that you really do know what God wants. And how do you know what God wants? Through the Bible. Because God has a plan. Starting from creation all the way through Revelation, God has a plan and he's laying it out for us. And he doesn't tell us every detail, but he tells us enough that we know what's going to happen. I'll get into something. I was listening to I didn't Sunday school, but I'm not going to use the name today, but I was listening to a television commercial, and the commercial said, "And I will show you how to have your best life now." Really? My best life is now? What about the future? What about when we stand in the presence of Jesus Christ? Complete, literally, as the song said, complete in him. Think it'll be a little bit better than now? think it'll be a whole lot better. With a new heaven, a new earth, no sin whatsoever. This person claims to have a knowledge of God's will, but you rarely hear him preach Scripture. That's sad. So, if we're filled with a knowledge of God's will, it should be characteristic of our whole life. Paul goes on to say that it's knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. Knowledge by itself doesn't mean a whole lot. I can read all the books I want about how to fix a car. I can read that book until I've got it memorized. And when my car breaks down, how much good do you think that book is going to do me? About that much, because I've never had any practical experience. Carl's done it before, and I've done it. Take a gun apart, pull it all apart, strip it right down to nothing, and put it all back together again. The books are great, but until you put your hands on it and actually do it, you really don't see how it works. But knowledge has to come from somewhere, and if you don't start with knowledge, you have a problem. Paul, talking about the Jews, said they have a zeal for God, but without knowledge. You need to know certain things, and that's where Scripture comes in, because God lays it out for us. But having the knowledge, God says, you need wisdom and understanding. And that's what he's praying for these people, that they'll not only have the knowledge of God's will, but that it'll be a knowledge that is in wisdom and understanding. And wisdom is just simply the correct use of knowledge. How to use it right. If you don't use it right, things don't work well. So you have to do that in some respect. And you know, if you turn to James for a moment, keep your finger in Colossians, but if you turn to James, after having talked about patience, in chapter 1 and verse 5 of James, he says, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given him. So when Paul prays for these people that they have a knowledge of God's will in wisdom and spiritual understanding, all they have to do, they know the facts, they'll learn the facts, and all they have to do is go to God and say, I need wisdom to be able to apply this, or I need wisdom to be able to help somebody, or whatever it happens to be. And God says, I'll give wisdom, and I will give it freely and liberally. That's neat. Use our present situation. We as a church should be asking God for wisdom. Our committee should be asking God for wisdom in how to go about doing things so that we start looking for people, which I believe we're doing, but that's what we need to do as a committee. But as a church body, we need to ask God for the wisdom that when God leads the right person to our congregation, we'll be going, yep, he's the one. Think God will give that wisdom? No question. He will, but we have to ask. Then he says spiritual understanding. What do you mean by spiritual understanding? Well, think of it this way. Who indwells the Christian? The Holy Spirit. You want wisdom and spiritual understanding? Wow. The Holy Spirit is there to teach us, to guide us, to lead us into truth. I think that's where spiritual understanding comes from. You know, talking in Sunday school this morning, I believe it was Paul made the comment that, you know, it's kind of hard to see how some people react towards God. It's almost like, what is sin? Who cares? Type of an attitude. You know, look around you in this world today. And what you and I believe, how many people out there are saying, "Oh, you're all wrong. You have to believe the way we do, because we're right." Well, Scripture says God's right. And God has given us spiritual understanding to see how things work in this world. And we may not be perfect at it, but think about the fact that as a Christian, your thought life, not just your actions, but your thought life is different. You look at things from a different perspective because the Holy Spirit is taking God's word and working in you. And Paul wants these people to have that kind of spiritual understanding. Then he goes on to say, and the whole purpose of that is that you may walk worthy of the Lord. And from there, it's like he's going to tell how that's going to happen. First of all, he says, pleasing him. Pleasing him. By, first of all, being fruitful in every good work. Being fruitful. Wow. Having things work out. Well, you know, think about those good works. Do they accomplish something? Well, if you have wisdom and spiritual understanding, God leads you into doing things that will result in growth in you first, but also in other people. Now think about this. Paul is praying for these people that they're going to grow, that they're going to have this kind of wisdom and spiritual understanding. It's great to pray for each other in certain ways, but one of the ways that Paul is praying here is that they will have this growth in knowledge, wisdom, and spiritual understanding, and we should be praying the same for each other. That each of us will grow in our knowledge of God, that each of us will grow in wisdom and understanding. But a part of that is not just knowing facts, but doing things. Walking worthy, living a life that is worthy of God, that is pleasing to God, first of all, by being fruitful in the works that we do. Not just doing them to doing them, to do them, but to do them to please the Lord Jesus Christ. And increasing, it says, in the knowledge of God. Increasing. Well, again, how are you going to do that? Well, I think there's two ways. First of all, what does God say in the Scripture? He tells us who He is. And the ultimate revelation of who He is came in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we want to know who He is, and we see the Father through Him. What did Jesus say? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And we want to increase in that knowledge, but knowing should lead to doing. Going back to that good works, being fruitful in those good works. And then he says, strengthened with all might. Strengthened with all might. Wow. One author put it this way. He said, a life pleasing to God is a life empowered by God. A life pleasing to God is a life empowered by God. It's great. Get up in the morning, jump out of bed, get dressed. If you're still working, many of us aren't. A good number of us are retired. But you go to work. And you just go about your daily tasks. And all of a sudden, at the end of the day, you realize, oh, I've been going through all this all day long, and I never really gave this day to the Lord. Oops. Maybe that's something that we need to think about. That we get up in the morning, we go ahead, we get dressed and stuff, but we say, Lord, please take this day. Please take this day. Give me the strength that I need to accomplish the things that you have for me. That may be at work. It may be in other areas. It may be that you need to go and help somebody do something. But Lord, give me the strength because I don't have it by myself. Later we'll see that there's false teaching that the church potentially faces. I don't think they've succumbed to it yet, but that the danger is there. Lord, give me the strength to see the truth and to obey the truth and not fall victim to false teaching. We're talking in Sunday school. The same preacher who wants you to have your best life now seems to ignore the scriptures that say things like, those who will live godly will suffer persecution. Where in Scripture does it promise that the Christian life will always be a bed of roses? It doesn't. Christians are going to have problems. Beware of false teaching. Well, Paul goes on to say, you're strengthened with all might according to his glorious power. That's where that comes from. For all patience and long-suffering. Now, this is an interesting thing because it says all long-suffering with joy, depending on your translation. It could say for all patience and long-suffering, and then it could be with joy giving thanks. The with joy can go with either verse. I'm not going to tell you which is correct. Commentators argue. That's what they're there for. They can argue all they want. We'll just let it stick with verse 11 for now, but all patience and long-suffering with joy. Patience and long-suffering are essentially synonyms here to reiterate the fact that we need to be patient in things, and when things don't necessarily go the way we want them to, we need to have patience. That patience that God is going to work things out according to His own will. Not my will, but His. I like to joke. I can change the problems of the United States in 1 year, but make me dictator. Probably would not go over well. I know it wouldn't go over well with a lot of people. It wouldn't go over well with me either. But you know, the only person who can truly rule is God Himself. And He is the ruler of this world. He may not rule in the ways that some people think He should. I listened to one clip of a false teacher who said, God's not in control on the earth. I actually gave his name this morning. I'm not going to do that. Not now. Later, maybe. But he said, God's not in control on this earth. Really? We read a couple verses in Daniel this morning. It talked about the Messiah and being given authority and dominion and a kingdom that will last forever. And when the Messiah came, Jesus, he said, repent. I mean, he did this, he had some of the same message that John the Baptist did. He said, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Jesus may not ruled the way people think he should, but he's still in control. He's won the war. War's done. It's the individual battles that aren't done yet. It's kind of interesting if you take a bird's eye view, for instance, of World War II, and you look after D-Day and how fast the Allies were moving across Europe, and then all of a sudden you have this horrendous Battle of the Bulge going on where the Germans made the surprise attack and they made this huge dent in Allied lines. And they would have prolonged the war had they gone farther, but they still would have lost. If you really look at all of history and what the United States and the Allies were able to accomplish, they'd already won the war. But the battle needed to be fought. And it was. And it was a nasty one. But it was there. Well, it's interesting. Endurance and patience. Corrie ten Boom wrote, every experience that God gives us, every person He puts in our lives, is the perfect preparation for the future that only He can see. Think about that. What a statement. Every experience, every person that we run across. Have you ever run across, well, I'm sure nobody ever has run across a person that really gets you upset. And you just like to haul off and either belt them one or shove them away and go away, get away from me, I don't want anything to do with you. None of us have ever felt that way about anybody before, right? Wrong. I'm sure we all have. How often do we see these as opportunities to show the love and the grace of God to somebody else? How easy is it when somebody says, "You're a weird clown, you did this all wrong," and all that, and our first reaction is what? To jump back and say, "Who do you think you are to talk to me like that?" Instead of saying, "Why do you think that? What did I do or say that caused you to think that way? Can we talk about this?" I know what my first reaction is, and it isn't that. My reaction is to get upset. It really is, too often. And that's not the way it should be. Characteristic of my life should be patience and long-suffering, the very same things that Paul is praying for these Colossians. And he says, with joy. Being joyful, not in the sense of necessarily, "Oh boy, this is great, I'm being persecuted," but just the understanding that God is at work. God cares, and he's moving from A to Z, and he's still working. He's working in this world, and he's working in my life to make me the kind of person he wants me to be. Paul goes on to say, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in the light. It is God the Father who has qualified us. We would never be good enough. Scripture says all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. All the good things, and again, it doesn't mean that you can't do good things for people, but on a human level, that's just what they are. Good that's done on a human level. But to please a holy and a righteous God, they will never work. Because sin is so horrible. And we talked about this in Sunday school this morning. Sin is so horrible. It alienates us from God. Because of it, Jesus Christ came and died for us. And we're going to actually see that more as we go through the book of Colossians. Paul says that we have an inheritance, and he doesn't define it here. But if you go to chapter 3 and verse 24, which I'm not going to read right now, but it appears that this is a future reward that is going to come. It's something we look forward to. But he is the one who's qualified us. He and he only. We can't qualify ourselves. He does it for us. Verse 13 says, he has delivered us from the power of darkness. Ooh, that's neat. He has delivered us. That's a done deal. That's the tense of the verb here. It's a done deal. You have been, as a Christian, delivered from the power of darkness. Sin does not have to rule in a Christian's life because God has delivered us from that. And it says he's translated us into the kingdom of the Son of his love. There's been a big move that's taken place. You know, looking at the slide that Bob had up earlier with the cross that was separate, you know, bridging the area between these two big cliffs. There's that divide there. And the interesting thing is, we show it in that picture, but that divide actually is infinite in its nature and in its width and in its depth. And Jesus Christ, on that cross, bridged that gap. He's the one who provided the salvation that we need so that we are moved from one side to the other, from the side of alienation to the side of fellowship with God and placed in his kingdom. Then he finishes it up by saying, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Wow. We have redemption. Saved from the power of sin through the blood of Jesus Christ. Scripture says without the shedding of blood there is no remission of sins. Some people really like to push back on that. And they'll say, well, it just means death. Jesus wasn't strangled. He wasn't smothered. He was cruelly beaten, beard ripped on, crown of thorns on his head, nailed to a cross. He shed blood on that cross. And then, the worst. Because in some sense, however that plays out, in a sense, the Father turned his back on Jesus Christ. And Jesus on the cross said, my God, why have you forsaken me? I don't understand how that plays out. But I can tell you, that's neat. Jesus died in my place. And he died in yours. And that results in the forgiveness of sins. Sin is forgiven, past, present, and future. And it doesn't mean that you go out and live the way you want to live. But it does mean that your sins are forgiven and you stand in Christ and will stand perfect before God. That's incredible. Paul is praying that for these people. He wants them to be filled with a whole knowledge of God's will and all of this. Everything about salvation and what it means and how to live. He wants them to walk worthy of that. And, you know, he tells them in some, first of all, by his power. And he says, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us. Boy, we need to be really thankful because of what we're saved from. He goes on to say that God has qualified us to be partakers of a great inheritance. And he's moved us from a kingdom of darkness, of alienation from God, into the kingdom of light, where we have fellowship with God. We have redemption, forgiveness of sins. Wow. Every single thing that we have as Christians comes because of Jesus Christ. Believe it or not, when we move into the next few verses, it's going to take 2 weeks to cover. Parts 1 and 2 of the preeminence of Jesus Christ and who he is. And we're going to see even more than what we see here, that it is because of Jesus Christ that we have what we have as Christians. So how do you get there? By trusting Christ as Savior. And if we've done that, if we confess him as Lord, he forgives our sins. That's a really, really, really important thing. Because without it, we're lost. As believers, Paul's prayer for these Colossians can serve as a model for us for praying for each other. So that we, as we are moving forward as a church, that we can pray for each other, not just for instance, and I'll pick on Paul again, but not just that Paul will be able to lead as chairman of the deacon board in getting a new pastor, but that Paul, and of course every one of us all ought to be thinking this way about every one of us as we pray for each other, but that Paul would grow even more in the knowledge of God and Jesus Christ. Because that's what he wants, that's what we should want, and we should want it for each other. Very, very important. And the fact that we need to rely on God for the power to be able to do it. Again, going back to verse 11, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power. Not mine, not yours, his. That each of us grows in all of these ways that we can grow in patience during the times when things don't go right. Things hurt. Anybody ever wake up in the morning and you're going, oh, I don't even know if I can walk today. And yet we sometimes just need the patience that God knows what he's doing. We'll get through the day because of him. And are we thankful, truly thankful, for the redemption that we have in him? Talked about it in Sunday school a couple different times. I still remember that in Ypsilanti, one of the guys who used to lead in the morning service said one day that when he got to heaven, the first thing he wanted to do was ask God for a tour of the universe. My personal opinion is, because I'm pretty sure given his age at the time, he's there. My personal opinion is, when he got there, that from a human standpoint, he fell on his face and said, wow, what I was saved from. Thank you, Lord. I never fully realized it until now. I truly believe that. You know, we talked again in Sunday school, Paul actually had brought it up, but Isaiah, when he had his vision of God and saw God on the throne, he said, woe is me because I am undone. He realized how sinful he was. It's one of the problems when you listen to way too many teachers today. There is no concept of what sin really is and how bad it is. But no, we're going to live our best life today. I said one time in Sunday school class, if you live your best life today, the next one may not be so hot. And Pastor Wagner said, it might be really hot. And he's right. If your best life is today, that's all you're living for. And we need to live for Jesus Christ. He died for us. He cares about us. Paul was praying that these people would grow in Christ. And we're going to see why as we, Lord willing, as we look toward the next times. And we're going to get interrupted, obviously, because we have the Sturgeons coming on the 12th. And then we got Christmas coming up. We got to do a bunch of good stuff for Christmas. So we're going to get interrupted in there. But we're going to take a look at Jesus Christ and who he is as Paul presents him in the book of Colossians and why that's so important for us to realize. Let's pray, shall we? Heavenly Father, we just, as we come before you, we just pray for your blessing upon your word, that it might have a real effect in our hearts and lives, that we might truly be thankful for the salvation that we have, and that we might look for your power moment by moment to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ as we should. That's now that you dismiss us from this time with your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. Paul?
In just a second, we're going to conclude the service with our final hymn. But once again, I want to invite you to our afternoon service at 1 o'clock, another great time of teaching. And as I said, it's a little more informal, interactive. And what we generally do for those who want to stay is normally you bring a lunch. And we sit around at the back tables and fellowship with each other for an hour, and then we have our teaching time, and it's just a wonderful time of fellowship, and it's a wonderful time of learning. So there are plenty of learning opportunities that we here have at this church. Right now we don't have a pastor, but I feel that the teaching here is still very strong, and we have great opportunities to grow in our walk with the Lord and our love for one another. Let's go ahead and finish up our service here today with this final hymn, Here is Love.
Here is love, vast as the ocean,
Dismissed.